And welcome back, and this is the final video in the series on properly basic beliefs and faith and reason, and I'll title the series How Do We Know Christianity Is True. I think that's a focal title. Okay, Alvin Plantinga is a 21st century philosopher. He is very famous and he's renowned and probably one of the greatest philosophers of Christianity that ever lived. He has a motto, what he calls properly basic beliefs. He argues that God is a properly basic belief. That when one experiences God, you can know God exists. And he gives a good analogy that helped me understand it, and I had to reread it a couple of times. So if you get confused on this, you have to watch the video a couple of times until you understand what I'm trying to say. So I'll try to make it as simple as possible. He gave an analogy. Suppose I see a tree. I see it, I experience it, then I walk away. It can be said, I know the tree exists, right? Same thing with God. Let's say I experience God, I acknowledge His presence, and then I just walk away. I can know God exists. If I experience God, then I can know God exists. I just said that. But people might say, well, I could be doubtful of that. I mean, people have seen aliens, and I doubt that they exist. But what Alvin Plantinga says that we know that God exists because there's something called an eccentric defeater in every person. An eccentric defeater is that it, when presented an argument against the belief X, you know that X is true no matter how powerful the argument is. For example, I have a thief who's in court, and I know, now let's say I'm in court and I'm the thief, and I know I'm innocent. I know it. And the plaintiff proceeds to give me argument, evidences, proof, mathematical, scientific, philosophical, if you will, proof that I am guilty. We even have cameras and everything. Does that mean I must say, oh, I guess I was wrong, I guess I am guilty? Well, no, if you do that, then you're a pretty stupid person. Of course you're not guilty, because you know, you experience, you have something in you telling you, hey, I'm not guilty, I was innocent, I was in the woods, or I was in the park at that day. In this time of the crime, I was not around the crime area. You know that because no matter how powerful the arguments are against you, you know that you are right anyway. So, same thing with God. The experience of God is so powerful that no matter how many arguments are presented against you, you know that you are right in the same way. Now, let me explain what I say with the tree and God. Now, there's something called cognitive faculties. Beliefs are formed by cognitive faculties. This is how beliefs get started. And I'm talking about any belief, not just religious beliefs. I'm talking about beliefs about the apple is red, or there is a bed in my room. Everything is that we believe, are formed by cognitive faculties. There were cognitive faculties when I decided to believe in gravity. Even though I didn't really decide that, I mean, it's kind of obvious. I'm going to drop this paper in the fall. So, but these are formed by cognitive faculties. These are belief-forming mechanisms, in simple terms. And when our cognitive faculties, belief-forming mechanisms, are in their appropriate circumstances, we can know that proposition X exists, or proposition X is true. Now, when I experience God, my cognitive faculties are functioning properly and they're in the appropriate circumstances, I can know God exists. To give an analogy, suppose I'm in my room and I look out my window and I see two green men in a flying saucer landed and they're kidnapping somebody, and they're putting them in a flying saucer, and they're about to go off to Mars. And my cognitive faculties are in the appropriate circumstances, namely, being at the that place, looking at the scenario that's going on. In the appropriate circumstances, and my belief in the mechanisms are functioning properly. That means that if I'm in the appropriate circumstances and my mechanisms are functioning properly, I can know that what I just saw is true. Now, this is the same thing about if I experience God and I'm in the right place, experience God, and my cognitive faculties are functionally, appropriately, I can know God exists. And we know this, and should not be doubtful because of the intrinsic defeater that's in us. That's how we as believers know that God exists. So, how are we warranted? Well, in simple terms, when our cognitive faculties are in the appropriate circumstances that God wants them to, that's how we are warranted in our belief. Now, Plantinga moves on to this argument from theism to Christian theism. He argues that Christian beliefs are equally warranted in the same way, that the Holy Spirit is a cognitive faculty, a belief-forming mechanism. That the Holy Spirit plays a role when the believer is about to believe. The Holy Spirit is in us believers, and it's in people who don't believe, because the Bible says the Holy Spirit grieves those unbelievers to know that it is true what is being said. For example, when I was presented with the Word of God for the first time, I knew that it was true. I was guilty. I know it was true. So, the Holy Spirit is a cognitive faculty that's functioning at that moment when I'm about to believe. When I'm guilty, feeling guilty, I know that what's being told to me is true. I'm in the appropriate circumstances, the Holy Spirit is functioning properly, and I'm in the appropriate circumstances where I can know that Christianity is true. And then I decide to believe in it. So here's the distinction on how do we know Christianity is true. We know Christianity is true by the Holy Spirit. And how do unbelievers know Christianity is true? Well, we present arguments and evidences to show that our faith is true. So that's how I think we are warranted. I think Plantinga's model is excellent. Beyond excellence. Beyond excellent. I have no words to describe it. It's amazing. This model is perfect. And I suggest that you rewatch this video until you understand what I'm saying. And you might want to check out Reasonable Faith if you have the book, or if you have enough money, go get it. And there is an even more lengthy discussion than the summary I gave of the argument. And maybe next time in my videos, I will make a video about an argument against naturalism from evolution. That should be interesting. Thank you.